In re Zanto. Peter Zanto. Appellant in pro se. Robin L. Stein. Counsel for Appellee Candace Amborn. Chapter 7 trustee.
All right. And Mr. Zanto, we have two different appeals. Do you understand which one is the first you're going to be arguing?
The 1148, Your Honor.
Okay. All right. I don't know that we had them in that order. I think we had 116. No, we did. Okay, you're right. All right, 1148. And do you wish to reserve any time?
Yes, 7 minutes for the reply, Your Honor.
Okay, thank you very much. You may commence.
Yes, Your Honor. Both these cases are very much related, and that I'm sure that the subsequent cases that the court has seen, I know that some of you or all of you are on the same panels for other cases, deal with one essential issue that is very specifically highlighted in this case. And all of the trouble, there's no better way to characterize it, all of the trouble that I've had in the bankruptcy court in Oregon boils down to one essential fact, and that is being blindsided by procedures that are just thrown at me as a surprise. And time after time, this has happened, and different portions of these issues are at various stages of appeal, and some are still in the bankruptcy court. But the issue in this case is very focused, and it really demonstrates the difficulty and the hardship that I've had in the bankruptcy court. The basic issue is that the judge asked for a report from the trustee. I objected, whereupon the judge reworked his thinking so that he could become non-culpable of the scheme that he was trying, that it was for informational purposes. And in the record, this informational purposes silliness only comes up after I've made the objection. And so my position in this appeal is what happened was that had I not made objection, a distribution would have happened without my consent, without my input.
Is that possible? How is that possible? This was just a report that was provided by the trustee. It didn't provide for distribution of assets. And there's a process. There's rules to be followed when assets are to be distributed. The trustee has to file documents with the court that provide for that, and then parties have an opportunity to object. That was not what was happening here.
So, with all due respect, Your Honor, my interpretation at that moment in time, and bear in mind, Your Honor, one of the things that's going on here is a person without counsel, without the ability to get counsel, is, for lack of a better example, just treading water while they're drowning. And after having gone through a multitude of deprivations on the basis of waiver and forfeiture, and in the 6 years that I've been before Judge McKittrick, this is the essential mantra that I've learned to understand, is that if I don't object in time, the judge will find some way to impose a waiver or a forfeiture on my rights. And this
let's assume, just for the sake of argument right now, that you're right. If you hadn't objected, something would have happened. I agree with Judge Brand. I don't think that's true. But let's just say hypothetically, so you objected.
Yes.
And nothing happened. Right?
Exactly.
Okay, so why an appeal? What are we supposed to do with this?
Well, I'd like you to say that I was right. I'd like you to say the good reversal that would be a benefit to me was that I was right in objecting, and that when the judge asked for the report, he should have specified what was the purpose. Was it going to be the final distribution? What was going to be the purpose? And most importantly, one of the fundamental problems in the Oregon Bankruptcy Court is the lack of notice and the lack of service to me. And so in the minute order that specifies the request, one of the key things that is not mentioned in that minute order is notice on Santo about the distribution. Santo has the right to object to the distribution. And again, Your Honor, I have to emphasize, I am the first to admit that I'm at a loss as to what I'm doing here. I am, after 6 years, destitute, without money, just trying to do the best I can. One of the things that I want to emphasize to the court that may not be evident in the record was that prior to the conversion to Chapter 7, which happened in November of 2017, in July and August of 2017, I became aware that I was in over my head. And literally speaking, I went to every attorney in Portland and the outlying areas, Beaverton, Springfield, and what have you. And it became apparent to me that the word was out. The word was out that any attorney who took my case would forever have the wrath of Judge McKittrick to deal with. And so nobody wanted to take my case. At that time, I had money, $50,000, $100,000 to defend myself. Nobody wanted to take it. And so this is a case where I apologize if my work is inept, if it sounds pedantic or pedestrian. I'm doing the best I can. And
understood. But there's, you know, for us to do something, you want us to, it sounds like, chastise the bankruptcy court. And that's not really our function here. Our function is to say something's right or something's wrong. So very simplistically, he asked for a report. You said, I don't like the report for various reasons. He said, I'm not going to act on that because I'm not going to, it's a report. I'm not doing anything with it. I'm not doing any of the things that you fear. So, to the extent you feared that the report was going to be a springboard for further action, it wasn't. And then it stops, and then you appealed. So it's sort of like you're appealing from getting what you wanted, which is, to the extent you feared a report, nothing happened from it.
No, not at all. I'm trying to protect myself. And in that process, perhaps the things that I do seem elegant. But you are correct on one point of that when I objected, the trustee and the judge backed off, and there wasn't a distribution. I didn't lose any rights. I didn't forfeit anything. I didn't waive anything. So I prevailed. And the nature of the appeal was that I perceived it as a victory from which I should take the next step to stop what I perceive as an involuntary bankruptcy. And so when we distill all that has happened in the last 6 years, yes, I began a voluntary bankruptcy in 2016. I thought it was going along well, and suddenly it turned into this nightmare. And my contention is that in November, when it was converted, it turned into an involuntary bankruptcy under 11 USC 303. And at that time, either the court, the creditors, the trustee was bound to file the paperwork to make it into an involuntary bankruptcy where they could seize my property, and this expropriation of assets had some basis. But here
Mr. Zanta, let me stop you for just a minute. You're past your reserve time, number one, and number two, that's not really the issue in this discrete appeal. At all.
I understand, Your Honor, and
So you can continue arguing, and you can argue about anything you want to, but if you want to reserve 7 minutes, you're already past it.
All right, I'll stop.
Okay, you don't have to. I'm just being a timekeeper a little bit here. All right. Let's hear from the Trustees Council. Ms. Stein.
Your Honor, may I please report Robin Stein for the Chapter 7 trustee and board. I think that the issues are pretty clearly briefed, and I don't want to go into all of the issues. I did just want to hit on a couple of things. First, that there is a standing issue in relation to the status report. It is briefed, but I did just want to start there. But putting aside the standing issue, the scope of this appeal is very narrow. It is just that there was a status report request. The report was filed. There was an objection. The court took no action on the objection. And then the Rule 60B1 motion followed. And then now we're here at this appeal. So really the issue, I think, is a lack of harm. I think it's very clear that Mr. Santo has a deep distrust for the bankruptcy court and for the trustee and for trustees counsel, as well as for the United States trustee and various other parties related to the different appeals. I think that's clear. And he made his objection based on that fear of waiver. But the court didn't strike the objection or deny anything or even overrule the objections. The court just simply took no action. So the objections are even still a matter of record. So to the extent that there was any fear of waiver, there is that record of the objections there. And so I think that there's just a distinct lack.
So the bankruptcy court, to the extent the issues reported in the report, at some point in time require the bankruptcy court to be decisional. He has not taken any substantive position regarding Mr. Zanto's arguments as laid out or statements of fact as laid out in his objection, correct?
That's correct.
Or he did not at the time. He refused. He just said it's not the time for it.
That's correct.
That's how I read it.
And in fact, there have subsequently been interim reports, which Mr. Santo objected to, proofs of claim, which Mr. Santo objected to. And to the extent that there's going to eventually be any distribution, that there would be a further court order or a notice and an opportunity to be heard.
All right. And so the time for decision for being decisional is yet to come.
That's correct. And like I said, because the briefing is pretty clear, unless you have further questions for me, I'll yield the rest of my time.
All right. Judge Brand?
Nope.
Judge Lafferty?
Thank you, no.
Okay. All right, Mr. Zanto, you have, I think, 5 minutes and something. Let's get your time up before you start so we know the... All right, you have 5 minutes.
Very good. I'm not having very much success explaining myself. I apologize. Let me try one more time. When your head is in the tiger's mouth, you've got to take action. If you don't take action, the consequences will be dire. So
let me stop you there because, okay, I'm going to assume for the sake of argument that there's a tiger's mouth, your head was in it, and you took action. And we're certainly not doing anything in this appeal to be decisional about this appeal between what the trustee reported and what you said, okay? And then the court ended, let's call this step one. You're on record, you've made your record, you've said your things. So no one is saying you couldn't object. He just said, I'm not gonna do anything now. So the question again, getting back to the appellate court is, what do we do with that?
All right, here's my suggestion, if I may be so bold.
Okay.
My desire is, as I pointed out in my papers, is an end of this bankruptcy, return to the status quo prior to filing, and to be done with it.
In the context of this appeal, again, we're very compartmentalized.
I understand, Your Honor.
In the context of this appeal, that's pretty bold.
And here again, this is the problem with Judge McKittrick's dynamic. Small steps. This is 6 years that I've been at this. It is gut-wrenching, and it is exhausting. And I am trying the best I can to block at every juncture that I possibly can further encroachment on my rights. So what I would suggest to the court, and I understand completely what you're saying. I understand the compartmentalization. I understand the limitations of your jurisdiction on this appeal. But what I'm looking for is some type of order along the lines, well, the judge has asked for a distribution report. That is a reality in time where the judge himself has decided that the time has come for the distribution. Now, let's have the trustee turn in something that's truthful. And this is the other problem with this appeal, that the documents that were turned in don't even begin to cover the amount of property that was stolen from my wife and myself. And again, while it's possible that 99.9% of bankruptcies go down a smooth track where nothing happens, everybody's on the level, everybody's honest, this is a case where the trustee, and now I'm on the second trustee, where the trustees are engaging in unconscionable self-enrichment at the almost urging of the bankruptcy court, where the bankruptcy court is prodding them on, you know, Santos is a derelict, Santos doesn't deserve to live. Here, trustee, get at it, take all his money, take everything, let him die. And this is the most crucial point of this, Your Honors. My wife has died because of this case. The most tragic part of this case is my wife, who was not part of this bankruptcy, had her property stolen. And in the 1112 conversion, the entire reason that the matter was converted was because my wife had not followed some instructions from the divorce court regarding renaming accounts that were put in her name. And so the entire matter of the conversion occurred solely and strictly because the bankruptcy judge accused me of hiding assets, not being truthful, when in fact the reality was that I disclosed everything, and accounts that I had been instructed to turn over to my wife by the bankruptcy court, my wife had not properly revested them in her name, or in the alternative, had revested them, but had done what she had a tendency to do, was to put a Toten Trust beneficiary on the accounts so that they would never escheat. And my wife, racked by guilt, racked by the
Mr. Zanto, your time on this appeal is up. So we're going to switch to the second appeal. Okay.
So you want me to go back to being calm instead of
Yes. Stuff
like that?
Yes. Yes. Thank you. So let's let the time clock restart, and then I want to make sure that this is the this one is the denial of the demand to return assets and motion to vacate under Rule 60, which it seems more to me what you were arguing previously.
Yes, Your Honor, and again, I'll reserve 7 minutes at the end if that's
fine. All right. Thank you. All right, you may commence.
And again.
And I don't know, Sarah, do you want to formally call this?